gospel in Romans and part 6, where we are, part 6. In our last instalment, we completed the law school, which was Romans chapter 7, okay? And saw the impossible situation we've been placed in. Because of the sin nature which we have inherited, our own bodies will betray us no matter how hard we try to live up to God's standard. In fact, the harder we try, the more certain our failure becomes. As far as affecting our own salvation is concerned, we're literally hopeless, helpless, worthless and useless. The Lord's remedy for our situation was to offer us an unmerited pardon, purchased with his own blood. Now we're ready to for a close look at the unbelievable blessings we call grace. Romans 8, 22 to 25. Please, Maxine. Romans 8, 22 to 25.
For we know that the whole creation groans and labours with birth pangs together until now. Not only that, but we also, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. For we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one still hope for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance.
Okay, just as creation groans, literally through earthquakes and storms, in the hope of being restored to perfection of its original state, we also desire to be free of the curse that's upon us, which is called our sin nature or our flesh. How we long for our physical bodies to be finally rid of the flaws and diseases that afflict us. To awaken each morning knowing for certain that never again will our thoughts and actions betray our desire to please God. Never again will we disappoint, embarrass or offend the one who gave so much for us. And finally, we'll be fit to dwell in his presence forever. This is our blessed hope. Romans 8, 26 to 27. Please, Di. Romans 8, 26 to 27.
Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God.
Let's take an example from the feeding of the 5,000. When the Lord fed the 5,000, he grabbed their attention. They followed him around all the Sea of Galilee, basically for another meal. But when he told them that he was the bread of life, and his goal was to give them eternal life, not free food, they went away disappointed, even angry. Like them, our minds are so polluted by our sin nature that sometimes we don't even know what we should ask for. We present the Lord with a list of our wants, make things easier, better, faster, all based on our immediate self-interest. But it's good to know that as we do, the Holy Spirit within us prays for us, asking for the things that we need, not the things that we want. Yeah. Romans 8, 28 to 30, it's never.
And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified.
If you look at it, those three verses, they deserve a study, literally, of their own. However, we'll just look at a couple of things. All things in verse 28 means everything. There are no exceptions. From the things that we consider are attacks, or setbacks, or failures, or outright disasters, he works all things together for good for those who love him. Now, we must understand that the word love is agape. We know that we have four words, okay? Eros, storge, philio, and agape. This one is agape.
Yeah.
The highest and most noble form of the word love. It means to be totally given over to the object of one's affection, irrespective of response. Question. Does that describe your love for your God? If it does, then what we're going to come on to will surely apply to you. Just what is his purpose in calling us? Ephesians 3, 10 and 11.
To the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord.
His purpose in calling the church is to demonstrate to all the heavenly powers the infinite variations of his wisdom. Amazingly enough, the angelic realms learn about the character of God by watching how he deals with us. And the phrase God foreknew means that he knew beforehand just who would come to be his. Now, we have a problem, because, and that problem is between predestinate and self-choice. This is the great problem a lot of people don't understand. Knowing these two words interact, or how these words interact, eliminates any conflict between two other words, agency and election. God doesn't force us or force himself upon us. In our own life, in our own time, in our own heart, we chose to be saved. That's called agency. Before he laid the foundations of the earth, God, who knows everything, looked across the time and saw us do it. Immediately he made absolutely certain that no one could interfere with this. That's election. That's called predestinate. At the proper moment in our lives, he called on us to do what he already knew we would do. And when we responded, he sealed us with his Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Many say that no one can ever undo it. But that is not to say that we cannot undo it. Let's look at John 3:16 to get a proper understanding of this.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
In fact, that's a poor translation of the original, because it misses out a thing called the present continuous tense. Present continuous tense. In John, in 1 John, he uses this all the time. Okay. The latter part of the verse should read, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever goes on believing in him should not perish, but go on having eternal life." In other words, there is a proviso that we must go on believing in him if we are to go on having eternal life. He gave us the right to make our own decisions. Okay? The greatest gift that God gave us was the right of self-determination. And each one, God doesn't choose some to be saved and some to go to hell. He gives everyone a chance. But he knows ahead of time what decisions we'll make. And he can write that down before it happens. When you think of it, prophecy is the history of our world written in advance. chapter. Another thing he did in advance was to justify us. To justify us means to regard us as though we were completely innocent. But regretfully, we're not. We're sinners. The only way he could do this was to take upon himself the penalty due for our sins, to die, in other words, in our place. When we accept his death as full payment for our sins, it allows him to see us as if we have never sinned at all. 2 Corinthians 5:17. 2 Corinthians 5:17.
Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is now a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new.
The great problem is that our sin nature doesn't become new. And so it's a fight from there on between the sin nature and the holy nature. Having made us righteous, he makes us glorious as well. And from his perspective, this has already been accomplished in eternity. Ephesians 2:6-7. Die. Ephesians 2:6-7.
And raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus.
If you read that again, look at it. It's past tense. He has already done it. And the most remarkable thing about it is that he didn't just forgive us, which would have been more than we deserve. No. He went way beyond anything we could hope for to give us an eternity that includes conforming us to the likeness of his Son, who is the image of the Father. Colossians 1:15.
Image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation.
Okay. Not only this, but he seated us beside him on his throne. Co-heirs and co-regents. Romans 8:31-34.
What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us.
When you think of it, those verses are quite fantastic. The Holy Spirit intercedes for us. And the Son intercedes for us. How will the Father, having given us all things, having given us the life of his Son for us, not also give us every good thing? It's quite amazing. James 1:17.
Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning.
Who could possibly dissuade him from this? Now, as we come to the end, believe it or not, of a short sharing, Romans 8:35-39. Romans 8:35-39.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I want to tell a little story, and Sheila's going to go, ooh. You don't know what more than a conqueror is. It's quite simple to explain. You know, the heavyweight champion of the world, he was sent by his wife to box for the title fight. And he spent 15 rounds being beaten up by this other guy. But he won on points. He won on points and he, whoa, great, super. He got home and his wife said, how did you get on? He said, I won. She said, where's the check? He's the conqueror. She's more than a conqueror.
Did you wear that, Ross?
No.
That's the point. We pick up the check. We are more than conquerors. Because we live because of Christ, of what Christ has done. We're not promised a life free of difficulty. Some of us already have or may endure hardship, persecution, or even death for our faith. But nothing that happens to us, nothing we're doing now or will do in the future, whether prompted by natural or supernatural motives, can change the fact that we belong to him. The only thing that can change that is if we stop trusting in Jesus. I thought about this, and I can imagine Paul thinking of Peter as he wrote this. Peter was the Lord's closest confidant, undaunted in his courage, eyewitness to hundreds of miracles, the first confessor of Jesus as the Christ. In the same night that Jesus was arrested, he drew his sword to stand alone between his Lord and a cohort of hardened soldiers. However, a lonely servant girl scared him into publicly denying that he even knew the Lord, cursing and swearing as he ran away. And yet, the Lord knew Peter's heart and restored him. John 10, 27 to 30. John 10, 27 to 30.
Is it me?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand.
30.
And I and my Father are one.
Okay. As I said, the Lord knew Peter's heart. Yeah?
Mm.
And terrible thing